need to use some time for those agreements. So we acknowledge AJ and his ministry for him. And one more time, big amen. Please begin to give the Apostle Pesul and Prophet Nathalie this morning. The Father and the Mother of this house. And we are grateful and greetings from our parents, Apostle Martin and Dawn. I'm humbled to be here this morning. Apostle, the woman has said, and what I'm not from the man has said, that because the Holy Spirit has been prompting, speaking to me about writing a book on the subject of your sonship. And it was my friend who was praying. Amen. Say, what up, man? Prophetic grace. Amen. Speak the apostolic dimension. Amen. But I received that grace, and I will definitely be making work of that. This morning I was speaking on the subject of your sonship because I believe that God is looking for sons in these days that are willing to take up their responsibility. I think we have too many actors in our days. I think we have too many entertainers in our days. And we have too little missionaries in our days. We have too little people, too few people that are willing to carry the burden of our Father's heart. And so I want you to go with me to the book of 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 2. And I'm going to try and teach this and not necessarily preach it. Amen. So that we can drive it home. I'm only going to read one scripture, and then we're going to dig into it. 1 Timothy 1, verse 2, if you have it, say amen.
Amen.
And would you please stand? We have the custom where we stand for the reading of God's word. So would you please stand with me if you have it? Amen. 1 Timothy 1, verse 2, it says, to Timothy, a true son, to me in the faith, we say, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. To Timothy, a true son to me in the faith we share. God blesses his word. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Beloved, the word own your sonship derives from the phrase own your essence. Take responsibility for who you are, what you are, and what you are supposed to do. I think it's important that we understand, first and foremost, that we become sons through the receptiveness or because we become recipients of the Holy Spirit. That you cannot be a son in the kingdom if you are an empty vessel as it relates to your relationship with the Holy Spirit. And because the Bible teaches us, and I think it's in the book of Galatians, that the Spirit in us, it says, therefore you are no longer slaves to fear, but you have become sons through the Spirit of adoption that cries out, Abba Father. So there are 12 gifts in the Holy Spirit according to First Corinthians chapter 12. But one of the gifts that the Holy Spirit also, because that's not the only gifts that the Holy Spirit has.
Yes.
So one of the gifts that the Holy Spirit also carries is to make us sons via adoption.
Yeah.
Are you with me? The Bible said that it's Jude as a taka fanatir. In other words, they are God's sons by selection, by birth. But they are sons that become sons via adoption.
Amen.
And you become a son via adoption by receiving the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Sure. Where there is no Holy Spirit, you will remain a foreigner. You will remain an illegitimate son. You will remain an illet, a bastard son. You will remain a bastard son if you do not have Holy Spirit. If you do not become receptive for Holy Spirit. Does it sound like me?
Amen.
And so we have to understand that sonship in the kingdom is me a theory than me.
Yes.
Sonship cannot be spoken.
Mm.
It's also by a mense for that grace now. What say a little sons? But when you validate their lifestyle and their action as it relates to what they claim that they are, you find that there is discrepancy or rather hypocrisy. Because they do not walk what they talk. So sonship is not a theory thing. We can teach you sonship. We can teach you the principles of sonship. But that will not make you a son. You have to decide to become a son because sonship is a practical method.
Amen.
Jesus says this throughout the book of John, where he says that I do everything the Father has
do. Come on.
As you remember, he does not, the disciples does not ask him, teach us the Father. They say, show us the Father. Because then that said Jesus, me, you can find me, you take a woman. Jesus says, now you have seen me. How is it possible that you are still asking me to show you the Father? Have you not seen me walk out the Father? Because if you have seen me, you have seen the Father.
Sure.
So Sonship, the Father's Son winds him. You cannot reflect your position in the relationship by showing us the book. We have to look at how you walk it out. Because as it relates to how you walk it out, it will speak to your investment in the relationship. We have to understand, my beloved brothers and sisters, that if we say that we are sons of God, the Bible says in the book of John 1:12, that whosoever accepted him, to become sons of God. Everyone who accepted the word. Amen?
Yes.
In the beginning was the word was with God, the word was God, and the word became flesh. And we beheld his glory. He dwelt amongst us, and whoever accepted him, he has given the power, the authority, the ability to become sons of God. But we have to understand, beloveds, that the Father's Son wineskin has one thing that holds it up, and it is the act of reciprocity. It is a given thing. It is a given thing. If you are saying that you are a son of God, and we see that God has already exhibited, or he has already brought his part to the table by giving his only begotten son. He has already given his only begotten son, and by giving his only begotten son, not only to open the blind eyes, not only to open the deaf ears, not only to raise up the dead, but to die on the cross of Calvary, so that there might be an empty tomb, because without the empty tomb, there is no Holy Spirit. Because Jesus makes the promise to the disciples that Holy Spirit cannot come lest I go. But I cannot ascend lest I descend. So the gift of the Holy Spirit cannot be given unto us unless there's an empty tomb. And via the empty tomb, we become sons. Now there's an expectation of you, my brother, that you ought to bring something to the table. Because in relationship from Father, Son, I see a fly-by-night relationship. I see a one-night standing. Therefore, when you become a son in the kingdom, you have to become a son to spiritual parents. Because in here, I see a fly by night, I see a game man in this business. This is serious business. Your responsibility as a son in the earth, it has an effect on the souls on the street.
Amen.
Your responsibility as a son in the earth has an effect on the souls on the street. Many people are waiting for you to come into accurate realignment as it relates to the Father's Son wineskin, not religiosity, not belonging to a church. Because the kingdom and the Father's Son relationship is deeper than belonging to the church. You understand this when you are a son, you are not the church. No. Also, but that being a misperception, that also as you can, you are not the church. You are a son of God. You are the habitation of the Holy Spirit. You are not the church. The church is a collaboration of people. It's a group of people coming together. Therefore, we are parts of one body. But the finger on its own is not the church. It's not the body. So you have to belong to a church. So if you are truly a son of God, you will understand that. So what's the more of my deal? Because you understand that, and that you have to belong to a church. For you are not the church. The Holy Spirit is in you, but you are not the church. The church is bigger than me, Apostle. The church is true investment. So it's not good enough to say, you're not coming to the building when you come here. You are coming here according to Acts 2:42. You are coming here for the teachings of the doctrine of the apostles, for fellowship, the breaking of bread, and prayer. You are not coming to the building.
Sure.
You are coming so that the corporate body comes together, so that the sons can come together, so that iron might sharpen iron, so that you can be a reflection on the, in the, in the earth of your sons, of the glory that rests upon sons.
Amen.
As a matter of reciprocity, because in the kingdom there is no such thing as you are only receiving.
Yeah.
Sure.
No. Your growth will not be influenced by you being on the receiving end only.
Amen.
I can't find you a swak Christian man.
Yeah.
And this is why you get people, they are sons in this house tomorrow, today. And then tomorrow they run, when there's an expectation of them, they run to another house because they only want to be in the receiving end. Hulle wil dit hê. Hulle moet gegee word. Hulle wil niks sacrifice. They don't want to lay off anything.
Sure.
Amen. So now what we are dealing with, beloveds, according to the book of Matthew chapter 26, 23, 25 and down, we see that Jesus now is sitting with his sons. He's sitting with his 12 disciples, and they're sitting next to the table, and he's saying to them prophetically, he's saying, the one that's going to put his hand with me in the bowl, he's going to betray me.
Yeah.
Now, Judas,
hy
vra vragtig, as het ek, you can read verse 25, 26, Matthew, hy vra, read. Nou, ek sê altyd die, ek sê ons sê, as ek Judas was, my mond gauw in my hand en my sak gesit, van ek weet dat ek is die ene wat kan van verraad. Why? Because I'm trying to prove the point that sonship is here, look at them. Judas has pledged his loyalty with his mouth, but his heart was already in disloyalty. Judas has committed as a disciple with the lips, but his heart is already disconnected, and now his actions reflect his illegitimacy.
Sure!
Hy het gesê, kan nie ek visie, maar as we look at how he handles things, if we look at how he walks with Christ, it reflects dat sy lippe taal, sy lippe, sy woorde, is maar net make-up, om sy true reflection te haal. Van in sy hand het hy klaar besluit, die is a benefit.
Amen.
Judas is in the relationship and is on the receiving end.
Yeah.
This is why when Mary Magdalene came to wash the feet of Jesus, as Mary Magdalene, and she broke the head of the vegetables, to say, hey, nah, man, ek kan nie dit iets maak. Because he was in the relationship, but he was sitting at the receiving end at the table.
Sure.
He was not willing to make the relevant sacrifices to become a legitimate son. And so in Father someone's doing is put that for son, you go, let me have to say, you become a son either by birth into the house, a legitimate son, and or you become a legitimate son by adoption. So what Paul is saying about Timothy in 1 Timothy 1, 2, he is saying now Timothy, he's saying to Timothy, a true son. The Greek word by definition for true there is legitimacy. A lawful son. Now, he did not birth Timothy. Neither was Timothy his biological son, but Timothy becomes a legitimate son to Paul through circumcision. Right? He becomes a legitimate son to Paul through circumcision. So now, beloved brothers and sisters, if we speak about owning your sonship, the first action that you ought to submit yourself, if you're going to be a son, and if you're going to be an effective son, because it is only effective sons, it's only true legitimate sons that becomes effective sons. So you have to, first thing you have to do, teacher Keenan, is you have to submit yourself to the process of circumcision. Circumcision by definition speaks of the cutting away. It speaks about the cutting away and the cutting away of the excess skin. It says skin, prophet, literally, has the potential to cause infection. Anything that is in the realm of the spirit, there is excess. When I say excess, it means it is unnecessary. It contributes nothing. It is important to nobody. The opinions that they have for others contribute nothing. Why? Because you have not been circumcised from your own will, your own desires, so that you can become a true son in the faith. So Timothy is now being circumcised. Ons kan gaan want sy pa was 'n Jew en sy pa was 'n Griek en dis is hom born ons aan gepraat dat die Jews toe kom want to take him for ministry. But the problem that Paul had with Timothy is that the Jews would recognize that Timothy ain't circumcised. And if the Jews recognize that he's uncircumcised, then he has no right to speak to them on the matters of the law of Moses. And so now Paul has to circumcise Timothy to make him a legitimate son.
Sure.
Paul has to circumcise Timothy to authenticate the message that he will be bringing. Because he cannot be apostolicized.
Sure.
He cannot be released, he cannot be sent, he cannot be given the responsibility and in the kingdom lest he becomes legitimate. Lest he becomes lawful. And by making him lawful now, Paul is qualifying him. Paul is putting the stamp of approval. So when he says in 1 Timothy 1, this is my true son, my legitimate son, we have to look at Philippians 2. Because in Philippians 2, we are checking what qualified Timothy besides the circumcision.
Mm-hmm.
In Philippians 2, Paul gives expression as to why he calls Timothy a legitimate son.
Yes.
He's telling the church in Philippians, listen here, watch this. Philippians 2, 20-22. I have no one else like Timothy who genuinely cares for you. Others are interested only in their own lives. They don't care about the work of Christ Jesus. You know the kind of person Timothy is. He has served with me in telling the good news like a son with his father. Prophet, the one translation says, Timothy is like-minded to Paul. You only become like-minded to the one who circumcises you.
Sure.
Amen.
If you can endure the pain inflicted by a father. And when I speak about pain, we are not speaking about abuse. We are speaking about the circumcision process to cut out of you that which God do not need to use you.
Sure.
When Paul says others, they only care about themselves, he is talking about men or sons that are like that of Judas. They only walks with you for their own desires. They do not walk alongside fathers because they have bought into the vision and has become like-minded as it relates to the work of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So Paul is saying, I'm sending Timothy to you because you do not have to worry about his intentions.
Sure.
I'm sending Timothy to you because you do not have to worry about him wanting something out of this. I'm sending Timothy to you because Timothy's character has already told me that I can trust him with the wealth that I have given him.
Amen.
May I submit to you that the prodigal son became prodigal because of his own actions.
Amen.
He became prodigal because he wasted the wealth of the father.
Amen.
He became prodigal because he wasted what the father has given unto him. So now, minister, teacher, Kenan, you came into the house, you became a son to apostle. Just to make an example, and you become an offense of him. You might have offense of him, just making an example. So teacher comes into the house, and apostle appoints teacher Kenan. He's the teacher in the house now. He has the responsibility, he's given him wealth, he's given him authority. You have the responsibility, the wealth that we are speaking about is the responsibility of the souls of the people that is given into his hands. In the absence of apostle Teswell, he starts to abuse his authority. He starts to abuse the excess that he has. He starts to abuse the grace that has been delegated to him. Because we have to understand, and as sons, we do not operate in our own grace. What we carry is but delegated to us.
Sure.
It is given to us freely.
Sure.
As a member.
Amen.
So we do not come, we do not operate in our own grace. You must understand, Paul says in fact, he says, you have delegated authority. So now what he does is, he starts to misuse that authority. So what happens now? The father isolated for me. Sy inability om wat aan hom gedelegeer is reg te gebruik isolate hom.
Ja.
Because the next time the father returns to the house, he won't be able to look the father in the eyes.
Ja.
He's wondering, wie gaat sê, ek het dit gesê. Hy wonder, niemand het hom gepiepie. Hy wonder in sy hart, and now because of his actions, he distances himself from the father, and he becomes prodigal.
Ja.
Because he misuses the authority that has been delegated and the access that he receives. So he becomes an outcast, not because we cast him out, but because he acted up. And he became an illegitimate son through his own actions. Now it was the tweede broer when he said, now the second brother, we had reason that he was prodigal in the house, and maybe we are right, but what we need to understand about the second brother is he was concerned about the wealth of the father. So now the other sons in the house teacher, that you are saying they are gossiping about me, and they don't want me to be part of it, and they are jealous. But the truth of the matter is, because your actions has disqualified you, the other sons is saying, I'm going to protect the business of the family.
Yeah.
We are not nasty with you, but for the sake of the business of the house, we're going to protect the business of the family.
Yeah.
So now you become prodigal, not because the father has given you wealth, not because the father has let you go, not because the other son is protecting the father. You became prodigal because you were on the receiving end of the table.
Sure.
Hallelujah.
And you were not willing to tap into reciprocity. You are not willing to uphold the responsibility and own your sonship, own your position, own your authority and your responsibility, but understand amidst it all, I'm only a son in the house.
Yeah.
Nothing more, nothing less.
Amen.
Ja, was iemand van dat?
Amen.
So Paul is saying, Paul, Timothy, look yourself about yourself. Timothy, gaan op in die Timothy, gaan nie veel, maar like in Timothy, gaan die little confused, I'm commissioning him because he has played his part as a son. Because he has allowed the process of circumcision to take place, and circumcision has cut out of him his own desires. Now the only thing he is concerned with, just like Jesus said, ik doe maar niet wat ik zie mijn paard. Zullen mijn zien dat ik jullie mijn paard zien?
Amen.
Zullen mijn paard zien dat zullen jullie van mij zien? Ik zie hier van mijn eigen business. Ik zie om mijn eigen koninkrijk te bouwen. Ik zie om mijn eigen visum te entertainen. But I am only up to my relationship. I'm only up to my responsibility. I'm only up to my position in the kingdom. And that is to be a son. Why? Because it is only sons that carries glory.
Sure.
Romans 8 says the expectation of glory. The heading on Romans 8 above, I think it's 18:17, it says the expectation of glory, and then it, the chapter starts to say, but the earth is waiting with her expectation. So, and it's waiting for sons, but I mean, it starts out to say the expectation of glory, which means that it's only sons that carry glory. The other counterfeit who the rebels and the Babylon of counterfeit glory, that's God's glory. It's not God's glory. And then sometimes we are saying, but I'm in a rebellious state, and the Lord is still saving souls and blood. That is what you mean, so God supports his work and his work. It does not support rebellion, because rebellion is a son of witchcraft. And so if you are not a son, you are a son in the house, you bring a blessing. If you are not a son in the house, you bring a curse upon yourself. Because sons do not build division, sons brings unity. Sons does not entertain competition. Sons complete.
Come on.
Amen.
Sons does not entertain gossiping. They do not entertain rejection, but they bring honor to the Father, which is our Abba Father. And I said to the church, I said to our church apostle, I said, you know, sometimes we want to overemphasize how you want to honor us. And we are not teaching you how to honor God. Because if you honor God, I won't need to teach you how to honor
God.
You will know that you have to honor me. You will know that you have to respect me. You will know in order to respect the glory of God, you have to respect the set man in the house. You will know that you cannot say in the name of Jesus, I override the sick man and woman. God doesn't override like that. Holy Spirit that come me to come and ik het maar net gegaan. No, it doesn't work like that. That's the order in Koninkrijk. There is a set order in the house. And when God speaks in the house, He speaks to that set man in the house. As I set man in zijn plek, and I set man zijn vrouw toe. Do you know what happened to Moses? God got ready to kill Moses. As in Exodus 14, where He wanted to kill Moses. And to sin as in Sapphira, zijn vrouw, to sin zijn man. Moses is in zijn plek.
Zipporah.
And God did not override Moses and then Zipporah. Zipporah could pick up that Moses wasn't doing the right thing because he circumcised everybody else except his own sons. And when she picked it up, she quickly circumcised her sons and saved the life of Moses. God will not use a son to save the life of a father. Sons do not qualify fathers. I'm not a father because I have two sons. I'm a father the moment Isaac got born. Shall we qualify many as a father? As the quantity, as the quality. This is why fathers, sons should never have the mentality that they are qualifying the father and the mother.
Yeah. Oh.
You do not qualify me. It must be roof where you want to. To change on to Isaac Mahir. You get what I'm trying to say? I'm trying to show you, beloveds, if we are saying that we are owning up to our sons, then not only should we speak the lingo, we should have the attitude, we should have the behavior that complements the lingo. So when we do speak, we speak out of the abundance of our heart. Why? Because the posture of our heart is right. I might not be able to give you R1 million today, Apostle, but if I'm your son, notice my heart is your heart.
Come on.
I cannot give you what someone else might give you, and I'm not discriminating against that person. I'm just saying that if that person's heart is right, then my heart is also right.
Sure.
Are you with me today?
Yeah.
It is a heart thing. Let us see a heart thing.
Yeah. Sure. Say it again.
It is a heart. It's a heart thing. I see a heart thing. It's a heart thing. And when we pursue our responsibility to own up our sons, then we understand how important it is when we buy into the vision of a father, when we buy into the vision of the father, then we begin to die to our own desires. I said to the sons last night that we were meeting, I said to them, when you buy into the vision of father, you understand that every sphere that God exposes to you, or you too, everything that God entrusts into your life, whether it's a car, house, money, whatever it is, you understand that there's something to do with the eternal purpose of God in your life. You understand? Whatever God gives me, it's got something to do with the eternal purpose. Ik kan het misschien nog nou detect. Ik kan het misschien nog nog duidelijken. Hoe kom je dit? Wat heet dit? Misschien is dat iemand dat duidelijk is. But the thing that you realize, if you own up to your sons, that nothing is your own. Nothing is your own. Everything belongs to our Father.
Yes.
Everything belongs to our Father. And sometimes God tests us with the simple things. And it comes to come on here, and God asks you, are you willing to give that shoes to the guy who has no shoes? Because if He can test you and trust you with the simple thing, 3 days in the kind of schooner. Ik heb nog in die kerk gestaan toen ik mijn baantje had. Oh, was die van die baantje op zijn eigen kadoetsie baantje proeven. En we hadden praten dat just came to the Lord. En ik had nog een jacket aangaan. En de Holy Spirit zei toen ik die jacket away. En ik was, kijk, en die baan was maar stoer wat hij baas was. Hij was mannen van die jaren wat hij baas in mijn oog gekoepen door mij. Want hij was soep bij mij. Ik had van de 3 days in de baas in mijn dier baantje. En die man had nog niks voor wat je ziet, man. De Holy Spirit is testing me. Do I understand that? That's not matter how much I paid for it. That's not matter how much I sweat for it. That's not matter what it cost me to get it. It does not belong to me.
Yeah. Sure.
Because what is happening now, Apostle, we want to be sons in the kingdom, and we want to be sons so that we become millionaires. We want to be sons so that we can get a position on the church board. We want to be sons so that we can get the title every next minister in line. And so we want to be sons because we want to be on the receiving end of the table, but there is no labor that goes with it.
Sure.
But the labor we put in, it is just to impress. It's not because we are bought into the visa.
Sure.
When we are truly sons in the kingdom, we understand that it's more about what we are willing to give up than what we are willing to receive.
Sure.
Than what we are willing to receive. True sons do not come up and say, my Lord is going to say, Lord, as I'll be a deal of a crack, as I'll be a deal of a deal. No. True sons is saying, ek het gesien, man, die stoel is heel te druk gepak. So I'd rather do that than wanting to be on the life. And we own up to our responsibility because it's deeper than our lingo. Paul is saying, Timothy, a true son, who has labored with me, who has labored, who has been in the vineyard with me, who has worked with me, he's like-minded to me. He has bought into my vision. My burden becomes his burden. My desires becomes his desires. Because what is Paul saying? He's saying to the church of Quran, he says, follow me like I follow Christ. He's not saying follow me as the man. He's saying follow the Christ that is within me. Because I, Paul, I'm already sold out to the kingdom. So if you follow me like I follow Christ, you will be sold out to the kingdom. As he met me. So we must, as sons, when we own up to our sons, we must evaluate our walk, we must evaluate our talk, and we must make sure that there's no hypocrisy within our life. We must make sure that we are not living a double life, and we are not living with double standards, that when the world looks at us, that they can truly see that I am a representative of the kingdom. That when the world looks at me, whether I'm in the valley or in the mountain, I still represent the kingdom. When I have food on the table or I don't have food on the table, I still represent the kingdom of God. Because I am a true son and I operate on that level of authority. And I know that in my father's house, there are many mansions that has bio-brewed. So I want to do such a prodigal son. I just need to come to myself, humble myself and repent. Because humility without repentance means nothing.
Come on.
You can say that you are humble if you have no repentance. You need to confess. Because repentance is not a repentance. It's not a repentance. No, you need to confess the thing that you need to repent. The Bible says, "Upabelijdenis is losmaak." You got to say. The Bible says in the book of James, "Belei mekaar julle sonde en bid vir mekaar sodat julle gesond kan word." You got to speak it. You got to say it. You got to let it out. To repent in order to become a legitimate son. Then you have to submit yourself to the painful process of being circumcised. Allow the spiritual parents of the house to cut away everything that is not needed. And we can learn something. When we started ministry, Apostle, I didn't see what I did wrong. You know, because I wasn't submitting to nobody. I was a pastor that was abandoned. I almost had gehaald. So now we were just doing ministry. And we were doing all the wonderful good and all the good and the men's applaud. But we realized that we are going in cycles until I submitted to a father.
Yes.
And the father who was standing on the outside looking in, he saw what was excess in my life. He saw what was unnecessary in my life. But him seeing it meant nothing. I needed to own up to my son's self and allow him to cut it out of me.
Sure.
And there were times, I need to be honest, there were times that I felt, but it agreed. No, that's what you're right. My it agreed. Because it was the things that made me comfortable.
Uh-huh.
But not made me productive. And make me effective. It was the things that made me comfortable. Coming up on a Sunday, going home. Coming up on a Wednesday, going home. Coming up on a Sunday, going home. It was nice because they could mention that we can pray. And then we had to go to Easter. And then we had to go and all of that. But it was challenging to let go of the things that made me comfortable. It was painful. But when I allowed him to cut it out of me, I saw now I became effective.
Amen.
Now he became effective. Now he's the name of a son. And he was kind of a son over the year. Tuma! That's no longer defective. Because we have become sons. I have become a son. And I have allowed him to process me so that I can produce more sons. Proverbs 19, then I'm closing. She said on Sunday, God sent, on Easter Friday, so she said, God sent a son to produce sons. In the same fashion, God is raising up fathers in the earth that can identify a son in you, my sister, so that you can go into the streets of Mitchell's Plain, wherever God has positioned you, so that you can produce more sons.
Yes, amen.
It is not just about you remaining a son and you are just here for the title. It is you becoming a factory, basically, that generates and makes more sons. So that when God comes, he looks at you and he says, well done, good and faithful servant.
Amen.
Because sonship shifts you into servitude.
Sure.
Not once can I say this, and I don't really know, not once have I ever challenged the correction of my father. I receive it.
Yeah.
I go to the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
I come back and I say that this is what I realize. Or whatever the case may be. Sometimes this is missing in power, that's the good. As your personal food and your personal labor. I got next when you care to do me. I have niks daarmee te doen in God's word. As I say, persoonlijke goed, hoe het ek my vrou treed, hoe het my kind treed, hoe het my geld speel, I personal goed, wat sy voel, maar het is niks met jou. You know, because what we understand as sons, then we are here to serve the kingdom.
Amen.
And if we don't get the personal things right, we will never be able to be effective spiritually. Because the devil is the accuser of the brethren. And he uses their personal flaws and failures and mistakes to accuse you. The devil is building a docket against you. I will in the courtroom of heaven gaan and I will gaan state prosecutor and say, this is docket wat ek tien aan hy gestel. He's building a docket against you, and what he's doing with the docket, he wants to disqualify you. And so you have to be able to grow to a place and say, I am willing to let go so that I can grow. I'm willing to repent.
Yeah.
I'm willing to forgive. Yes. I'm willing to submit. And sometimes we really think sonship is only about, like I said, obedient. But the thing is that after you said yes, are you doing what you said yes to? Are you with me? Are you committed to what you said yes to? If you come into the kingdom of God, let me in the hemel to begin. Ik wil op my hemel to gaan. Ik wil het ingaan as. It's a gift, it's clear, it's available. You can do nothing to go into heaven. So that your garment white is. There is unrighteousness of your sin. Because daar gaat je ingaan. You know, that is it. You know, ek sê altijd vir die volk, daar gaan die hek van die hemel. As our metal detectors is. That's why I say they're sin detectors. John said, and I've seen them with their garments pure white, and on them they are linen of righteousness.
Come on.
So as they have a heck of come, and I'm sick, man, it's sicker that your garment fit us. But the hymn is there for you. You can hymn to go. The regas on the hand, say, you're not going to give me Jesus. And I have it. But while you are here, how effective are you?
Nog
zijn. Maar ik ga niet alleen. Maar ik zeg, het is only sons that can do that. Het is only sons that make sure that they're not going to go on their own. Ik wil niet alleen om te gaan. Mijn familie had geen bij man van mijn kans om te praten bij die family gatherings. Ik was naar een groep dat zei, ik moet gewoon het eerste die zien. Alle nooit als je naar vrouw, maar nooit naar papies toe. Maar dan ga ik wijn die zien, ik daar zien. Ik ga zieken, maar ik roep het zomaar om. A stress. Now I'm sick. Why? Because I don't want to go to heaven alone.
Yeah.
I don't want to go alone. It's there for me, but I will be alone. I was sick, man. That when I got income and I can't inquire, that I didn't say no more after the numbers. You know? But we have to own up to our sons, beloved. Own up to your sons and make the Father proud. Make our Abba Father, the Spirit in us cries out, Abba Father. Make our Abba Father proud. And maybe you can't be doing that. I must challenge you. You are sitting here today and you realize that there are some things that need to be cut out of your life. you realize that there are some things that need to be cut out of your life, and you want to let go of some things that has made you an illegitimate son. I bet you are not a son yet. Don't know what it means. You heard the sermon today, but you want to know more. You want to go deeper. You are in the right place, in the right space today. Came to the right house. Here in this house, we do not produce church members. We make disciples and sons. We see you mega churches about when we are here to boast about chances. But if you can influence, but you are sitting here and you are realizing that there's some stuff that needs to be cut out. Excuse me, out of your life. Then I want you to stand to your feet if that's you. There's sometimes some stuff that you need to lay off, that you need to let go so that you can become a legitimate son. You are saying for years you have taught the kingdom. You have preached the gospel, but you have not lived it.
Amen.
When we are, if we are supposed to take a stencil of the word today and put it on your life, then we will find inaccuracies, errors within you, because you are not walking the right path.